രാജ്യം ഇന്ന് നേരിടുന്ന ഏറ്റവും വലിയ വെല്ലുവിളിയായ ദേശീയ പൌരത്വ ഭേദഗതി ബില്ലിനെതിരെ പ്രതിപക്ഷ കക്ഷികൾ സുപ്രീംകോടതിയെ സമീപിക്കണമെന്ന് സിപിഎം പോളിറ്റ് ബ്യൂറോ അംഗം പ്രകാശ് കാരാട്ട് പറഞ്ഞു. ജനാധിപത്യത്തിന്റെ ജനാധിപത്യവൽക്കരണം എന്ന വിഷയത്തിൽ സംസ്ഥാന ഗവൺമെന്റിന്റെ ഇൻസ്റ്റിറ്റ്യൂട്ട് ഓഫ് പാർലമെന്ററി അഫയേഴ്സും കാലിക്കറ്റ് സർവകലാശാല പൊളിറ്റിക്കൽ സയൻസ് പഠനവകുപ്പും കാലിക്കറ്റ് സർവകലാശാലയിൽ സംഘടിപ്പിച്ച സെമിനാറിൽ പങ്കെടുക്കാനെത്തിയ അദ്ദേഹം മാധ്യമങ്ങളോട് സംസാരിക്കവെയാണ് ഇക്കാര്യം പറഞ്ഞത്.
ഡെമോക്രാറ്റിക് principles of the constitution. We have to fight this on two fronts. Immediately, I think all the concerned parties must go to the Supreme Court to challenge this law, because this goes against the constitution, against provisions in the constitution like Article 14. The other is to conduct a very widespread and powerful campaign among the people, mobilize the people so that there can be sufficient pressure built that in the future we can bring a change in this law, reverse this law. Already you have seen big protests in Assam and the Northeast. There was a bandh yesterday and the protests are continuing. We hope to build such a powerful countrywide movement against the amendment to the Citizenship Act. Thank you.
Dr. C.L. Joshi, Professor Ram Kumar, Dr. D.P. Divakaran, other fellow speakers at this seminar, and students and teachers of the University of Kozhikode and friends. It gives me great pleasure to be here to participate in the seminar on a vital subject for us all, which is about the future of democracy in India. The theme of this seminar is titled as Democratizing Democracy, which seems to be a contradictory thing, because democracy is democracy. So what is the necessity to democratize democracy? But I think this title speaks volumes about the state of democracy in India. Democracy is now very sick in India, and the treatment prescribed, I think, in this title is that you have to inject a big dose of democracy into the democratic system in our country, which is visibly weakening, visibly wilting before our eyes. It is now 70 years since the Republican Constitution was adopted, under which we have the parliamentary democratic system. If we look back at the 7 decades experience of the democratic system, it is creditable how parliamentary democracy has retained its vitality over the years. This is mainly due to the people and the popular struggles and democratic movements that have taken place. The participation of ordinary people in the elections at all levels have been marked by sustained enthusiasm. However, the political system cannot be said to have transformed the lives of people by securing their livelihood, by abolition of poverty and the structures of exploitation, and providing equity with economic growth. the Constitution of India in its directive principles directs the state to provide, to promote the welfare of the people by securing, I quote, a social order in which justice, social, economic and political shall inform all the institutions of national life, unquote. It calls for the state to strive, quote, to minimize the inequalities in income, unquote, and to see that the, quote, control of the material resources of the community are so distributed as best to subserve the common good, unquote, and to ensure that the operation of the economic system does not result in the concentration of wealth and means of production to common detriment. This is what was set out in the directive principles of the Constitution. 7 decades later, when we look back at how we have pursued these goals in the Constitution, there is no doubt that the working of the state and policy making are clearly contrary to these goals set out in the Constitution. Much of the conflicts and crises in our system can be attributed to this contradiction. Political democracy coexisting with concentration of wealth and economic inequalities. This is the basic contradiction. And it was this essence of the contradiction which was spelt out by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in the following words when the Constitution was adopted. And I would like to quote from Dr. Ambedkar. On the 26th of January 1950, we are going to enter into a life of contradictions. In politics, we'll have equality, and in social and economic life, we'll have inequality. In politics, we'll be recognizing the principle of one man, one vote, one ballot. In our social and economic life, we shall, by reason of our social and economic structure, continue to deny the principle of one man, one value. And then he goes on to say, how long can we live this life of contradictions? And this growing contradiction will one day blow up our political system itself. 70 years of experience of democracy in India underline the necessity for democratizing and revitalizing our democracy if it is to continue to serve the interests of the people. Why does the need for democratizing democracy arise? I think there is a threefold reason for this, which is as follows. First, there is a dissonance between formal democracy as prescribed in our Constitution and its actual practice. Second, there is a growing dichotomy between political democracy and the widening social and economic inequalities. And third, there is a serious threat to democracy from majoritarianism. I'd like to, in this brief talk of mine, focus on these three features or factors which are today threatening our democracy, weakening our democracy, and how we should be able to meet this and counter this. The Constitution of India provides for political democracy which is grounded in equal rights for citizens and the provision of fundamental rights. as against the formal structure of democracy, over the years there has been an attenuation of democracy and democratic rights for citizens. The last 7 decades have been punctuated with violations of fundamental rights, suppression of democratic rights and civil liberties, and in the current phase, efforts to subvert the constitutional scheme of things itself. What we are witnessing is an undermining of the democratic, secular and federal principles embedded in the Constitution. The starkest example of this is the denial of elementary democratic rights and fundamental rights for citizens belonging to Kashmir. 70 lakh people in Kashmir have been in the past 4 months living in a regime where they face restrictions on their right of movement, right of association, right to communicate, and even the right to life and liberty. That this can happen, and even the Supreme Court has failed to intervene to uphold the fundamental rights of citizens, is a grim reminder of how much democracy has been eroded under the present regime. Here you have a situation in the last 4 months that there is no internet operating in the Kashmir Valley. So students who want to apply online for the NET and various examinations, they are unable to do so. Traders have said that they are not able to place orders for essential drugs and medicines which are required for the people in the hospitals. Today, there are hundreds of people who have been detained, preventive detention. They don't have to be produced in court. They cannot get bail. And in many instances, the state, when the courts, when we go to the court, like in the case of the CPM leader, Mohammed Yusuf Tariqami, whose habeas corpus petition was taken up in the Supreme Court, the state comes and says he is not under detention. They deny his detention. But if you go to Srinagar, you cannot meet him. You are prevented. He cannot come out of his house. And the state appears before the Supreme Court and says, we have not detained him. And the court accepts that at face value. Except when we said that he needs medical treatment, they said yes, you can ask him to come to Delhi for treatment at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, but he must go back and then be detained again. So this is a habeas corpus petition, which means in Latin, produce the body. You go to the court and say so and so has been, he's not found, he's missing, he can't contact him. And the government comes before the court and says, so and so is living in his house, he is not detained. But we cannot see him, he cannot come out, all his movements are restricted. This is what is happening to 70 lakh people. And this has been happening for 4 months, little over 4 months. So this is a prime example of how basic rights of citizens have been deprived with impunity, and no constitutional body or structure, institution is able to intervene to safeguard the rights of citizens. So this is what I said. The gap between what is professed as your democracy and fundamental rights in the Constitution and in actual practice on the ground, you can have a regime which means a complete denial of democracy. This is not seen in India by all the institutions that say there's something violative of the constitution, violative of fundamental rights and human rights. It has been seen like this by international opinion. More and more countries are expressing concern. For instance, in a modern society, the right of communication, no internet, everybody is able to understand immediately that you are in some form of detention or captivity. But in India, this is the stage we are in. This is taken to be necessary on grounds of national security for the sake of protecting the integrity of the country. So this is the first point I would like to make, that we have reached a stage where you can have state-sponsored, institutionalized deprivation of basic liberties and rights of citizens, and that is considered to be par for the course. The second factor is the growing divorce between political democracy, which ordains adult franchise and equal rights for citizens in the political sphere, and in contrast, the exponential growth of inequality, both economic and social, something which Dr. Ambedkar pointed out 70 years ago, that we are starting with this life of contradictions when we adopt the constitution. But what has happened? Over the years, I said, every directive principle in the constitution about reducing inequalities in incomes, of adopting policies for the common good, etc., etc., all that has been given the go-by, and with neoliberal policies having been implemented for the last 3 decades, we have seen inequalities of income and growth have grown tremendously. Today, 10% of the people, or 10% of Indians, own 77.4% of the wealth, and the richest 1% control more than 51% of this wealth. This concentration of wealth and inequality is infringing on political democracy. Big money and corporate power have invaded the political system. Business and politics at every level, starting from the panchayats to the parliament. Big money has flooded the electoral system. More and more businessmen and capitalists are being nominated as candidates by various political parties and getting elected to parliament and legislatures. And thus policy making is increasingly suborned to favor the super rich and international finance capital. The most naked expression of this intrusion of big capital into electoral politics is the system of electoral bonds which have been introduced by the present government. These anonymous bonds can be utilized by the corporates, both Indian and foreign, to finance the ruling party without being identified or any questions asked. This scheme was introduced in March 2018. How it was brought in itself is a scandal. In Parliament, the amendments to various other laws, like the Representation of People Act, like the RBI Act, etc., etc., the Companies Law Act, all these amendments were tagged on to the finance bill and they were declared to be a money bill, so that it could not face scrutiny in the Rajya Sabha. And in the Rajya Sabha, they didn't have a majority. I'm talking about the previous term of the Modi government. And therefore, they were adopted by the Lok Sabha as part of the budget. What are the amendments that they made? When I said foreign and Indian, they have defined foreign companies having operations in India, having subsidiaries here, or even branches here. They are considered to be Indian companies if they have conformed to the FDI norms for those particular sectors. So you have a big multinational company which has an Indian subsidiary or branch. They can donate money to a political party and they will be considered as Indian money, not foreign money. This is one amendment which was brought up. Second was, till then, the law was corporate donations are allowed. Though we are against it, but it's legal, it was legally allowed. So a company could give up to 7.5% of their average profits over 3 years. In the last 3 years, profit up to 7.5% limit was there. Suppose you earn 100 rupees, you can give 7 rupees 50 paise as donation to a political party. They have now removed that cap completely. You can, no 3 years profit is to be there, no limit is there. So you can set up a shell company and give unlimited amounts of money to a political party. And third, all this can be done through electoral bonds. They are like bearer bonds. There's no name. Who has issued it? Who has to be given? That bond can be given through the State Bank of India to the designated political party. The Income Tax Department nor any other agency can ask for the details. Where is the source of the money come from? Who has given the money? You have to just say, I have received XXX crores through electoral bonds. Now this system in 1 year, between March 2018 to May, that is till the Lok Sabha election is over, in 2019, over 6,100 crores worth of bonds have been issued. And in the first two installments of the bonds issued, 95% went to one party, that is the BJP. So we can predict on that basis that the 6,100 crores of rupees, 95%, 90 to 95% have been given to the BJP. Because though these bonds are anonymous, since it goes through the State Bank of India, the bank knows who has given this money, and through from the State Bank, the government can easily find out who has given the money to whom. So nobody will dare to give it to an opposition party. That is why 95% of the bonds money has gone to the ruling party. Now this is an organized way of ensuring corporate influence and power in the political system. Because you do a favor to a corporate, the kickback will be in the form of an electoral bond. That is legal. You can't trace it. You can't say this money has been given by this company to me, to you. So this is, as the Reserve Bank of India, which objected to the bonds when it was first being proposed, they said this will increase the use of shell companies, black money and foreign money flooding the political system. They opposed it. Though so did the Election Commission. Despite that, through the subterfuge of a money bill, they got this bill passed and it is in operation today. So what you are having is a corporate takeover of the political system. What happens in this system is you can vote for a change of government. After 5 years, you say, I don't want this government. But you change your government, the party which comes a new party comes to power, you find that party will also pursue the same policies, economic policies, because they are also financed and funded by the big business and corporates. So democracy today means, as it happens in all the advanced capitalist countries, you can change a government, but you cannot change the economic policies. That is democracy. Because whichever government will come will pursue the same neoliberal economic policies, because they are entirely working as agents financed by big capital, by big money. And in India today, much of the perversion of democracy that you see, the horse trading, political party leaders or elected representatives crossing the floor, going to some other party after being elected. Behind this, if you look at it, I did an analysis of the first 15 MLAs who defected from the Congress and the JDS to the BJP, your neighboring state, Karnataka. All of them, without exception, all 15, were either in the real estate business or doing other businesses, contractors. Every one of them was having a stake in various businesses, either in real estate, in getting contracts, construction business, liquor business, etc., etc. For them, the reality is not being affiliated to a party or an ideology. The question is, what will serve our business interests best? So the BJP today is a party on the upswing, which is dominant. Being with that party will help my business interests. That is all. Just like MPP Nagaraj, the man part of the Mandum defected. When he was elected, he had declared his assets, and he was the richest MLA in Karnataka. He was a congressman at that time. He declared a total of 120 crores. And they said he is the richest man. Now, 2 years later, he has declared over 1,000 crores as his assets. How he managed to increase from 120 crores to 1,000 crores? When he fought this by-election, he has showed 1,000 crores. Unfortunately for him, he was one of the few people who lost on the BJP ticket. All the others won. Out of the 15, 13 won. But he lost. But this is the nature of money power and this nexus of business and politics, which has now completely undermined the political system today. What you saw in Maharashtra, glimpses of that were there and that also. Which person goes to which party or what motivates them? Because they can be caught for corruption or they have been running shady businesses. You are afraid of the agencies, the ED or the CBI income tax. That decides which party you will go and cross over to. So this is the second major factor whereby with neoliberal economics we have got now neoliberal politics, and that is reflecting itself in all the non-left parties of our country today. The third factor which is playing a serious role in denuding democracy of its essence and the constitutional liberties is the rise of majoritarianism. India is today ruled by a party which bases itself on the Hindutva concept of majoritarianism. This majoritarianism, based on religious identity, is profoundly inimical to secular democracy. The test of a democracy is how it protects the rights of the minorities, whether it is religious, linguistic, or ethnic. That is the test of a democracy. Does it safeguard the rights of the minorities? Not just religious minorities, it could be linguistic minorities, it could be ethnic minorities. The Hindutva worldview strikes at the roots of the secular and democratic principles in the Constitution. Hindutva nationalism seeks to impose its majoritarian view on the minorities. It seeks to homogenize all cultural and social values under the rubric of a Hindu nation. It seeks to stamp out diversity and suppress all dissent. And that we have seen in the past 6 years, that there have been, according to one survey, 113 deaths due to mob lynchings. Out of that, more than half is the cow vigilantes who have killed on the basis of accusing somebody of either stealing cows or eating beef or smuggling cows, etc. More than half the lynchings have been due to the Hindutva gangs attacking those who they think are transgressing their code regarding the cow. The others are like, there have been a lot of child-lifting scares, and there have been lynchings of people, innocent people, suspected of kidnapping children, etc. It happened in a large way in Jharkhand, in West Bengal, etc. That is the crudest form of attempts to coerce, terrorize the minorities and those who dissent and have a different view about their lifestyle. But the current example of the crude majoritarian communal view is the adoption of the Citizenship Amendment Bill, which was passed in the Rajya Sabha last night, and now it has become a law, the amended version of the Citizenship Amendment Act of 1955. Now, why are we saying that this amendments to the Act are antithetical to the Constitution, violative of the basic postulates of the Constitution? Article 14 of the Constitution says the state cannot deny equal treatment of persons living in the Indian territory or equal protection of the law for all persons living in the Indian territory. It does not say citizens, Article 14. It says all persons, every person living in Indian territory should be treated as equal before the law and get equal protection from the law. From that, the next article follows, Article 15, which says there can be no discrimination based on religion, caste, creed, sex, etc. So, the amendment made to the Constitution, to the Citizenship Act, what does it say? It says those people who have come into India illegally from 3 countries, Afghanistan, Pakistan and Bangladesh, who belong to either Hindu religion, Sikh, Parsi, Jain, Buddhist, etc., 6 religions, if they have come from these 3 countries illegally, they can become eligible for citizenship. Under the present law, anybody who has come illegally cannot be eligible for citizenship. So they have said, yes, but we are differentiating people from these religions who come from these 3 countries, though they are illegal migrants, they will no more be treated as illegal migrants first. Already they have passed orders 2 years ago, 3 years ago to treat such people, don't deport such people. They can be deported under the Foreigners Act or Passport Act. First they ordered all these people come from these 3 countries, from these religious groups, cannot be deported, no proceedings should be taken against them. Next step now they are saying, we'll make them eligible for what is called citizenship by naturalization, because they live in the country for a certain period. What does that mean? The present law says anybody to become a naturalized citizen must have lived in India for not less than 11 years. That has been amended for these sections of people, that if they have lived in India for not less than 5 years, they can apply for citizenship and get the citizenship. So first, they have no more illegal migrants. Second, they can become naturalized citizens and the time span is being relaxed so that they can quickly get their citizenship. But this will not apply to Muslims coming from these 3 countries. Even if they have come 15 years ago, 20 years ago, they will be still illegal migrants. But Hindus or Parsis or Buddhists or Christians, they can become naturalized citizens. They will no more be illegal migrants. So for the first time in India, we are going to have a law which defines or decides citizenship by the criteria of religious affiliation, which goes against the basis of the Constitution, Article, as I mentioned to you, 14 and 15. That you cannot say, all of you are illegal migrants, all of you have come and lived here for the last 15 years. But out of that, people from this religions, they can become citizens. People from these religions, they will remain illegal migrants. That is what this amendment has in effect done. So that is why we say that, what is the purpose of this? Underlying the purpose of this, the Home Minister Amit Shah went on saying in the Lok Sabha and the Raj Sabha that you caused the partition of India through the Congress Party, because they came to power at the time of independence. And because of partition, we are undoing this legacy of partition. And what is that legacy? The BJP and the RSS genuinely think all Hindus should come to Bharat and all Muslims should go to Pakistan or Bangladesh. They sincerely believe in the two-nation theory. The two-nation theory was not proposed only by Muhammad Ali Jinnah. Before Muhammad Ali Jinnah talked about the two-nation theory, Savarkar had already talked about it in 1923. Their ideologue, V.D. Savarkar, had already propounded the thesis that we are two nations, Hindu and Muslim. So what Amit Shah means today by saying we are finishing the unfinished task at the time of partition, which is there was no proper exchange of population. Actually, all Muslims from Bengal, the western part of Bengal, should have gone to the eastern part, and all Hindus from the eastern part of Bengal should have come into West Bengal. This was not done fully. Now we are facilitating it. Here's an open invitation to Hindus from Bangladesh, come over, you will get automatic citizenship. If you live here 5 years, your citizenship is guaranteed. And the second part, which is not being talked about, you cannot separate the CAB from what is called the NRC. They are doing the CAB first in preparation for what is coming next, which is the National Register of Citizens. They have declared it will be for all India, not just what they did in Assam. What does that mean? You will have to prove you are a citizen of India if you want to get to the register. No other country in the world, citizenship proof is on the citizen. It is always the state. which say if the state has any doubt that you are not a citizen, then it should investigate, proceed and take action. Today, if you want to get rid of foreigners, there is enough laws. There is a Foreigners Act. There are foreigners tribunals. You can say, this person, he's come from outside illegally. There is a process by which you have to make a case. He has to be put before a law tribunal, and the tribunal will decide whether it's a foreigner, he or she is a foreigner, and then you can deport them. But this National Register of Citizens is a more insidious thing. It is to ensure that we can keep this threat hanging over the Muslim minority in this country. That if you can't prove your citizenship, you don't have the documents, you don't have the what in Assam was called legacy documents. You have to prove your grandfather was there, your grandmother was here. You have to prove by actual documentation. Only then you will be allowed to stay. So that is going to be done for the entire country. And it's going to start on the 1st of April 2020. People don't understand this. They talk about some NRC. But they've already amended the Citizenship Act during the Vajpayee government. It will start with the National Population Register enumeration. And already Amit Shah has declared, from the 1st of April to the 30th September, this house-to-house enumeration will start, like census. It will not be for you to prove. They will come to your house, ask, have you been living here? You must have been living here at least for last 6 months. Then you will be enumerated. The National Population Register will be the basis for the NRC. But there is one rule they have introduced in the Citizenship Act rules, which is if the enumerator has any doubt that you are not a citizen, then he will report the matter to the supervisor and you will get a notice. And you will have to appear before the National Population Register supervisor or whatever, the taluk level or tehsil level, and you will have to prove that you are actually long time resident of India, you have got all the documents, that means that you are a citizen. So the screening will start next year when the National Population Register is going to be taken up. And after all the doubtful people are decided, then they will proceed against them, and then only the national NRC will be finalized. So you are going to have to remember, this is only the beginning, the CAB. The CAB plus NRC, it's a pincer attack. The CAB will ensure that Hindus who are here in the country illegally, who come from neighboring countries, they will be given citizenship. And the NRC will ensure that all the doubtful, what Amit Shah calls ghuspaitis, the infiltrators, the termites, they will all be eliminated. So what will happen all over the country? In the next 1 or 2 years, you will find this Hindu-Muslim divide being created, village by village. Especially in states like West Bengal, the bordering states to Bangladesh, there is already panic. You go to West Bengal today, you will find long queues outside the collectorate's offices, outside the Tehsildar's office, outside the BDO's office, both Hindus and Muslims. Because a lot of Hindus have come from Bangladesh. They also have, like in Assam, the majority of the Hindus have put in the excluded list, because they don't have documents. Today you will find all government offices have to work overtime because people are standing in queues to try to get some document to prove that they have lived there, their ancestors have lived there, they have land there, they have this there, etc. So this is the... So what democracy will it be if you have in a country citizenship based on religious affiliation, and the creation of a two-tier citizenship. That's what is going to happen. One will be full-fledged citizens of Hindu Rashtra. The second will be, they cannot deport all these people. In Assam, if you say 19 lakh people are not citizens according to the NRC list, 19 lakh people. They can't all be sent to Bangladesh. Bangladesh won't accept them. So they'll remain in India, they will remain in Assam, but they will not be having the right to vote. Already there is a list called in Assam, D voters, D for doubtful. It's been there for the last 10 years. They cannot vote in the election because they are not proven Indians. So you will have this grey area. In Assam it's 19 lakh. I don't know how many millions will be there in West Bengal in this category. They will not have full rights of Indian citizenship. And because they are not full citizens, you can easily deprive them of various rights. Right to livelihood, right to education, right of this, etc. So you'll have a second class citizenship also in India. This is what we are heading for. So Hindutva majoritarianism will effectively demolish the secular democratic framework that we have. So therefore, the greatest threat to democracy in India today is coming from this Hindutva majoritarianism. It is therefore necessary for us to embark on a struggle to protect democracy and defend the democratic rights of citizens. Now this cannot be done in the narrow confine of a constitutional legal battle. As I told you, if we have faith in the judiciary to bail us out of this situation, it's not going to happen. You have learned that from our bitter experience of how they have dealt with the Kashmir situation. Either they keep delaying, that 4 months have passed, there are cases in the Supreme Court saying 14-year-old boys have been put in jail under the Preventive Public Safety Act. The Honourable three-member bench first asked for a report from Kashmir. After the first report, now they said, we want a second report. Already 4 months have passed. By the time they give the verdict, that minor will become a major. Juvenile will become a full-fledged adult. So there is this judicial escapism. Somebody has used the term, Gautam Bhati. I think it's a very adequate term, judicial escapism. You don't want to confront the state when it does wrong. So in that situation, what we require to do is, this is a struggle which is multifold, multidimensional. For this, we have to wage a sustained and arduous struggle against economic and social inequalities and the policies which engender them. You have to start with that. It requires doing away of the neoliberal economic policies and replacing them with pro-people alternative economic policies. Because with this sharp economic and social divide and inequality, democracy cannot survive. So first thing is, take up this. The second is, the defense of democracy entails the defense of the rights of the socially and economically oppressed and the various minorities that we have in our society. This means the struggles to safeguard and advance the rights of the Dalits, Adivasis, minorities, women, etc. And it also requires the doing away of the draconian laws that are there in the statute book. There are hundreds and hundreds of cases of sedition filed against people all over the country. Sedition. The British law, which was any attempt to overthrow the crown, that is sedition. Today, any attempt to overthrow the government is sedition. Even if you write an article criticizing the government, you are charged under the sedition law, 124 or 125A of the Indian Penal Code. Then you have more draconian laws like the Prevention of Unlawful Activities Act, where if you are arrested under that act, you can't get bail for at least 180 days. No bail. It was 90 days and now it's been increased to 180 days. So this is the architecture of authoritarianism, of draconian laws that has to be dismantled. And the third point is the pollution of democracy by money power has to be curbed. Here we have to take small steps to begin with. There has to be a ban on corporate funding, introduction of state funding, in kind, not in cash. Corporates can fund, but they should put the money into a state fund, which will do state funding of the election. They can't.
പ്രാദേശിക വാർത്തകൾ വേഗത്തിലറിയാൻ ഈ ചാനൽ നിങ്ങൾ സബ്സ്ക്രൈബ് ചെയ്ത് ബെൽ ബട്ടൺ അമർത്തുക.